Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And he has ascended. And that is a reason for us to celebrate. I want to welcome all of you here and joining us at home to celebrate the ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. This year, our ascension worship is built on the theme hymn, On Christ's Ascension, I Now Will. But we'll begin with the ascension hymn, Hymn of Glory. Let us sing.
Praise to the Lord, to God our Savior, who daily bears our burdens.
For God a song of praise.
God reigns over the nations. God is seated on his holy throne.
Clap your hands, all you nations. Shout to God with cries of joy.
How awesome is the Lord Most High, the great King over all the earth.
Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises.
The historical account of Christ's ascension from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. I wrote my first book, Theophilus, about everything Jesus began doing and teaching until the day he was taken up, after he had given instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After he had suffered, he presented himself alive to the apostles with many convincing proofs. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and told them things about the kingdom of God. Once, when he was eating with them, he commanded them, "Do not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for what the Father promised, which you heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they were together with him, they asked, "Lord, is this the time when you are going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or the seasons the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." And after he said these things, he was taken up while they were watching, and a cloud took him out of their sight. They were looking intently into the sky as he went away, and suddenly two men in white clothes stood beside them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why are you standing here looking up into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Last year at Pastor's Conference, we pastors learned a new game. Now, so that you don't think that all we do at Pastor's Conference is play games, it was at break time, and there was a pastor who brought along a game called Suspend. I don't know if you've ever played that, but each player gets a number of oddly shaped metal pieces, and then each piece, as you take turns, is hung on this structure that's kind of hanging there in the middle. And you have to be careful. You have to be sure that what you're hanging your piece of metal on is going to support it. It's going to be a good place, because if you knock all of those metal pieces down, then you get all of those metal pieces that fell down, and the object is to get rid of all of them. You have to be sure that it's a good spot to build on, to hang your life on. That's what we see in God's Word. A place to build our lives on. Our hope, not only for this life, but for the life to come. And in God's Word, we see the places to build our lives on, the manger, the cross, the empty tomb, Jesus' ascension into heaven, and his promise to come back. Those are things that we build our lives on, our hope. As we sing about in our next hymn, "On Christ's Ascension, I Now Build."
Pastor mentioned the ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ is something to build on important things for this life. And one of those very important spiritual things for this life is repentance. That you and I are repenters is of eternal importance. You remember what the Lord Jesus said, "But unless you repent, you too shall perish. Remember Pastor Martin Luther's commentary on repentance in his 95 Theses, that when our Lord Jesus Christ said repent, he willed the entire life of every believer to be one of repentance. In repentance, we daily go back to our God and say, I'm sorry. If you think about it, that might not be such an easy thing to do. You've all been there at different parts in your earthly life where you had to go up to someone and say, I'm sorry. Maybe it was an occasion when you were thoughtless with your spouse, or you forgot something big. Oh, no. What are you going to say? Oh, no. It's going to be bad. Or maybe when we were children and we did something wrong, and Dad said, you know, your mother and I are going to talk about this. And then we're going to talk to you. And you're sitting there for those minutes that seem like forever. Oh no, what are they going to say? Or if you've been the student that you let your sinful nature get the best of you too much, that now you're going to have to visit the principal's office. Oh no, what's going to say? What's going to happen? Or if you messed up at work, boss calls you in. What are they going to say? Could I lose my job? In repentance, mere mortals, created beings who by birth and nature are sinful and detestable to the holy God, the creator of all things, they come before him, and we're going to say, I'm going to tell you what you already know. I'm going to own up to you. Times that I thoughtlessly, and the times that are really bothering me, the times I knowingly and willingly defied you. What's he going to say? When you come to your God in repentance, what's he going to say? You know. I forgive you. Are you sure? Absolutely, you're sure. You've received forgiveness and the ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's something to build repentance on. Why does Jesus ascend? It's because his work is done. And what was that work? John the Baptist, the baptizer, said, look, the Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world. And when that work is done, Jesus ascended. And you think of how the Apostle Paul encouraged us in kindness that leads us to repentance. We know what he's going to say. I forgive you. Because our Lord has ascended, I now invite you to stand. And let us use our order of confession to come before him with repentance, with words printed that will help us think. And then a time of silence to think for ourselves. Always looking forward to what's he going to say. Brothers and sisters, the reason the Son of God descended to earth was to pay for our sins and live a holy life in our place. Let us confess to God our need for a Savior.
We have not been loving.
As you have called us to be.
We have been critical.
Too easy on ourselves.
We have been too busy doing things.
And not busy building your kingdom.
We have taken family and friends for granted.
And treated them disrespectfully.
Our love has been conditional.
When we have not forgiven others or loved our enemies.
Our witness has been silent.
Because we are too scared. Too quickly selfish.
Forgive us, Lord, for these and all sins of which we are not aware.
Heavenly Father has had mercy on us. He has sent his only Son, Jesus, who was punished for our sins. For his sake, God forgives us. May he now strengthen us to live according to his will.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
I build my comfort and my confidence. A reading from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. This is why, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I never stop giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep praying that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, will give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in knowing Christ fully. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you may know the hope to which you were called, just how rich his glorious inheritance is among the saints, and just how surpassingly great his power is for us who believe. It is as great as the working of his mighty strength, which God worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule, authority, power, and dominion, and above every name that is given, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. God also placed all things under his feet and made him head over everything for the church. The church is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. I always knew that shoes were expensive, but this was a little bit ridiculous. I heard about a pair of shoes sold by an auction house within the last week or two for $1.8 million. Apparently they belonged to Kanye West and he had used them on some fashion runway or something. It was set a new record. The old record belonged to shoes that belonged or were made for Michael Jordan at $560,000. I guess they didn't get those on clearance with Kohl's cash. I don't know. If those shoes are just so comfortable, or maybe they give you that extra bit of confidence. You suppose they do? Maybe for a little while, comfort and confidence, but not for very long. Not for the big things in life, like how do you deal with heartache? And what happens when we have to leave this world? There, the only place to find confidence and comfort is in what God's Word says. In what God has done. Did you notice what Paul was pointing the people to as he was praying about? I pray that you might see all the more clearly our Savior Jesus, that you might see the glorious riches that he brings for you. How wonderful it is that he's restored the relationship between God and man with his rescue mission. How wonderful it is that when we see all of this bad stuff happening around us, that we can see sitting there at the controls of the universe, at the right hand of God, is our Savior Jesus, the one who loves us enough to die for us. And it is in his help and his strength that we live day by day. And let's continue then by singing, day by day, your mercies, Lord, attend me.
Yeah.
Christ's ascension, I now build my purpose. A reading from Ephesians 4, verses 7 through 13. But to each one of us, grace was given, according to the measure of the gift from Christ. That is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took captivity captive and gave gifts to his people. Now, what does it mean when it says he ascended, other than that he also had descended to the lower parts, namely the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. He himself gave the apostles, as well as the prophets, as well as the evangelists, as well as the pastors and teachers, for the purpose of training the saints for the work of serving, in order to build up the body of Christ. This is to continue until we all reach unity in the faith and knowledge of the Son of God, resulting in a mature man with a stature reaching to the measure of the fullness of Christ. Happy Ascension Day to you. Happy Ascension Day to you. Happy Ascension Day, dear Christians. Happy Ascension Day to you. Now, I am certain that all of you recognize that beautifully sung melody as actually coming from the Happy Birthday song. And we all know what happens after you sing the Happy Birthday song, right? Oh, there might be a blowing out of the candles, and there might be a serving of cake, but then what happens is present time. Present time, the opening of gifts, and unless you're too old, of course, to care about that anymore. You know, for Ascension Day, you also get to open some gifts. We celebrate Ascension Day, and the scriptures tell us that Jesus has gifts for us. But look at what it said. When he ascended on high, he took captivity captive and gave gifts to his people. So let's just spend a minute or two looking at some of the gifts the ascended Lord Jesus has given to you. He himself gave the apostles, as well as the prophets, as well as the evangelists, as well as the pastors and teachers. Some of the gifts that God, or our Lord, ascended Jesus has given to you is the gift of people in your life. Back then, he gave apostles and evangelists, prophets. And back then and today, he gives his church, you, the people, gifts of your pastors and teachers. Jesus completed his ministry, but he made sure his ministry would continue by setting up a public ministry that proclaims the gospel. And he uses people to do that, gifts. Now, some of you might not realize it, but today was a special day for Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod. There were some gifts that were given. This Saturday is assignment day at Martin Luther College, where the graduates are going to be assigned, but you might not know that the work of assigning them is already done. It happened today. Those tasked with that job did their work. It won't be public until Saturday, but the gifts have been given. God has given you as his people the gifts of your pastors and teachers too, and there's a purpose behind it. Is our purpose the Lord Jesus has given to entertain you? Is that why he gave us to you? No. Is it so that we can boss you around? Is it so that you can boss us around? No. This was the purpose. For the purpose of training the saints for the work of serving. The reason that Jesus gave these gifts to the church is so that every believer could be trained to do works of service. That's why you see your pastors and teachers here not just doing the things that you've called us to do, but other things that are helpful for the ministry of the congregation, because we know that teaching is done by deed as well as word and by example. But that leads us to another gift that Jesus, the ascended Lord, has given you. Purpose. If you want to, after service, Google my purpose in life and find out how many hundreds and thousands of self-help book guides you can get to help you discover your purpose. Forbes magazine, Psychology Today, all of them, they are willing to help you find your purpose. And do you see? You got a leg up on them because Jesus ascended. You know your purpose. To do works of service that will build up the body of Christ. The way God has things set up, literally everything we do, whether we eat, drink, whatever we do, can be done for his glory and in such a way that it will serve other people. With that always goal in the front of our mind that hopefully we'll get a chance to talk about the Savior, and it's going to build up the body of Christ. Jesus ascended because his earthly purpose was done. And when God's purpose for having you on this earth is done, you will ascend too. But you haven't yet, have you? That means that you have purpose. Works of service. Build up the body of Christ. Happy Ascension Day. Let's join now in singing another great Ascension hymn. The first four verses, "Hail the day that sees him rise."
On Christ's ascension, I build my peace. A reading from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. If you've listened to the news this past week, you know that it has not been a very peaceful time in the Middle East. Bombs and rockets have fallen, and tear gas and stones have filled the air, and along with screams of hate and pain. But that unrest isn't just on the other side of the world. We see it sometimes in our country, and we see it in our lives, all too often caused by something we've said or something that we've done. But we have a Savior. A Savior who changes everything. He's completed his rescue mission of living and dying and rising again for you and for me. And his promise is there that he's going to come back to rescue us from this world of unrest where there is so little peace, no lasting peace. And Paul says that because of Jesus, we can rejoice. Rejoice no matter what is going on around us. Rejoice in the Lord always. And then we can see Jesus makes a change in our lives too. Let your gentleness be known to all. The Lord is near. Let's reflect that Savior's love in this world around us. And then we can take all of those things that are bothering us, and we can take them to our Lord Jesus. Present your requests to the Lord, and his peace passes all understanding. And we hear him say, "Do not let your hearts be troubled."
Thank you.
Christ's ascension, I now build the hope of my ascension. Jesus' ascension gives us all sorts of blessings for this life. But this life is not where it's at. The life to come is. Reading from John chapter 14, basis for the song we sing. Jesus says, do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to be with me, so that you may also be where I am. You know where I am going, and you know the way. Lord, we don't know where you are going, Thomas replied. So how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I'm going to ask you to do something that's probably going to be a little bit difficult for you. I want you to do your best to think of living your life as an atheist. That means someone who has convinced themselves God does not exist. There's no God. There's this life, and then that's it. There's nothing after that. So you talk about meaning or purpose in life. There is no meaning for your life other than what you choose for yourself that it should be. And then when you cease to exist, maybe you hope someone cared enough to care about the things you cared about and carry on. Your purpose in life, you don't have unless you choose one for yourself. And then you die, you cease to exist. And maybe, hope someone thinks that was a great purpose too. You live your life looking forward to ending, ceasing to exist. Can you imagine living like that? I can't. And because the Lord Jesus has ascended, I don't have to. And neither do you. I have been with families when God has asked them to deal with the difficult thing of their baby dying. I have been with families when God has asked them to deal with the expected but still difficult thing of aged parents dying. They all have the same desire, the same hope, to be with them again, to see them, to have the hurt gone and taken away. Happy Ascension Day. Because Jesus Christ ascended, you get to know that that day is coming for you and every believer in Jesus Christ. What did he say? If I go, that means I will come back to take you to be with me. That you can be where I am. And I'm going to prepare for you mansions, not a room in the Motel 6, mansions. Drive down Lake Drive, see the big homes. Go on the right side of Lake Geneva sometimes, see the mansions. Cardboard boxes, that's all they are. Compared to the glory and the joy that Jesus has prepared for all those who believe in him? What did the angels say? That this same Jesus who was taken up from you to heaven will come back in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven. On Christ's ascension, we build the hope, and that's the biblical hope, not the I wish hope, but the sure expectant waiting for our own ascension. We'll get to be with him. Because Jesus is the way. He is the way for the youngest one of your loved ones who died in the Lord. He's the way for the oldest of your loved ones who died in the Lord. He is the way for you and for me too. On Christ's ascension, we get to build. It's no wonder we celebrate Happy Ascension Day. And let's now use as our prayer the Lord Jesus to come back and take us to be with him. The Ascension hymn draws to thee.
If you're comfortably able to do so, please stand for our prayer. Blessed Lord Jesus, you ascended to the right hand of your Father's majesty, where power and glory are, and you now reign as the eternal King of kings and Lord of lords. We praise you for your victory over sin, death, Satan, and hell. Give courage to our hearts, power to our words, and success to our efforts as we work to share that good news of Jesus with others. And when the devil comes with his attacks, defend us from Satan's every accusation with the assurance that you have paid for all of our sins and completed your rescue mission. And O ascended King, direct everything in this world to serve the best interest of your church and to give you glory. And as the disciples lifted up their eyes to watch your ascension, so lift up our eyes every day to look for your coming again in glory. And O Lord Jesus, come quickly. Amen. We join to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another and serve the Lord with gladness. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen. Amen.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah, and he has ascended. So good to have all of you here or joining us online to give the worship and praise to our ascended Lord Jesus Christ. Certainly want to give a thank you also to those who performed the works of service to build up this body by cleaning or decorating or with music or getting worship helps ready and cameras and everything else. Much goes into that.
I want to thank everyone who was a part of that. I'm also aware that one of our church family here tonight is ascending way up there in years with another birthday. It's Miss Lynn Growth. And boy, is her growth older and older. But since you do know that happy birthday song was so beautifully rendered unto you before, why don't we join in singing her a happy old birthday?
Happy birthday to you.
Because Jesus has taken away our sins, heaven is our home, we get to celebrate and laugh. Have a great night. Everyone, keep rejoicing. Feel free to say hello to those around you before you go. Thank you.